first big question that I have is, whose responsibility is governing big data? Usually in Parliament, we give government the last word. Today, you get the first word. Chris.
Thank you very much, Chris, and thank you for inviting me. My role, as I said, is in the Government Office for Science, and for people who don't know, that supports the Office of the Government Chief Scientific Advisor, and so it's in that capacity I've been invited today. It's someone called Sir Mark Walport, who you may have heard of, and he really cares about this stuff a lot. Formerly Director of the Wellcome Trust and now Chief Scientist. And the way he frames his responsibility is supporting the objectives of government, which is growing the economy and looking after the health, well-being, security of the nation, of citizens. And you can see by just glancing at the post notes that there are enormous opportunities across all those areas. But there are also risks. So the role of government is to maximise the former and mitigate the latter, I would say. Before I give a few thoughts on how that might happen, I just want to sort of highlight a general point in this area, which is that this question is quite often set up as a utility-liberty dichotomy or a risk-benefit, where it's actually... Context is extremely important for all of these discussions. What data, with whom, for what purpose, under what conditions? So I just wanted to throw that in early on. For government itself, I think government's role has to be enabling. And that is about having, okay, one part of it is about having, you know, a good proportionate regulation. But it's also about building capacity. So building our capability, our skills, our infrastructure, perhaps in the research community. But it's also about fostering a debate and enabling debate around getting these rules right. It's not just government, of course, who has a responsibility here. There's responsibility for business, responsibility for individuals. A sort of final reflection is that technology has always driven social norms. When cars first emerged on the scene, you know, people would walk in front of them waving a flag to make sure everyone got out of the way. We now tolerate 5 deaths a day in this country because of the utility cars give us. So society will evolve around this technology, and we just have to keep up to date with it.
Thank you very much, Chris. It's relevant that you should bring up cars there. Susan, as our resident transport expert, if government's the enabler, what's the role of business?
Well, let me say something first of all about the transport sector itself. Mm-hmm. I think it's probably true to say that most of us who are here today have got some experience of the transport system, and indeed possibly some views on some of the difficulties we've got with that system. But the transport system, by which I mean the highways and the vehicles and the systems that connect parts of the infrastructure, is essentially data driven. So we've dealt with big data over a number of years. We've collected this and we've analysed it, and we've used this for the benefit of transport policy to try and develop better policies and to be able to better manage this system, which is now not only close to saturation but oversaturated in many areas. So I wanted to say that because I think it's very important that when we talk about big data and the opportunities, we have some notion that these data are very important to us, but also that the kinds of problems that they can help us to overcome are very real problems and issues that we all encounter on a day-by-day basis. I also wanted to say something about governance of big data, not just from my own experience and my experience as a transport researcher, having worked in this sector for 25 or more years, but I wanted to say something about how our understanding of how ordinary people in the community feel about governance of big data, particularly in the transport sector. Mm-hmm. Because we've done some research with people and we've asked them some of these questions, and I think that the views of ordinary people matter when we're seeking some solutions to this. What we've found out is that, first of all, I'm often asked, well, are people willing to share their data to construct mobility profiles? In other words, patterns of people moving through the system. Why would people want to do this in the first place before we start to worry about issues such as privacy and data security and so on? And the fact is that people are actually willing to share their data on a voluntary basis and on an informed basis with permission. And this kind of sharing goes on through the kinds of devices that many of us have got, so through our mobile phones and through our laptops and other sensors in the network. And I thought it would be interesting for people to understand why they would want to do that. People want to have some change to the system. So one of the pieces of feedback that we got was, I'm willing to share my data because I just want the transport system in Leeds to be better than it is at the moment. People are willing to share their data because under some circumstances they feel adequately rewarded for doing so. They feel that there is some kind of value proposition for them from doing that. And that often comes from enhanced information which allows them to plan their own journeys better and to be more efficient. Or in some cases it is from rewards that come through things like discount vouchers, or in the cases of research we're sometimes rewarding and compensating people to be able to use their data. There are people with serious eco concerns, and the links between transport and sustainability are well established now. So some people want to share their data to encourage a better future in terms of a more sustainable transport system. And finally, there are some particular kinds of applications that bring us particular benefits, such as those that allow the tracking or the location awareness of family members, where people really feel as if there is a lot of value from doing this. So I felt that was important to put on the table. But when we ask people how they would like their governance, their data to be governed, people, first of all, are very much aware of risks with this one. It is about mobility and location and where they are. But the arguments are more nuanced than that, because it's not just about risk and it's not just about privacy. People feel they want to have control, so they want to share, but they want to have control. And they have quite a lot of objections about the idea that some commercial competent companies may financially benefit from access to their data. So they are more likely and more willing to share for purposes such as benefiting the community, improving the transport system, than they are willing to share to allow commercial organisations to benefit. And finally, we asked people, who would you like to govern your data? What kinds of model would you like for this? The vast majority of people who we spoke to wanted a non-commercial storage arrangement with data. They were actually very trusting of transport suppliers and operators and senior stakeholders to govern their data, far more so than commercial organisations. And in fact, the views on whether government itself should handle their data were very polarised. So some people felt yes, but quite a lot felt no. So, you know, in terms of the governance argument, I hope that puts something on the table about how people that we surveyed in Leeds feel about that.
So there's an interplay between the role that government, business and individuals play for ensuring that governance of big data is...
Indeed. I think this is absolutely key, because there are individuals, I know that there is some strong feeling about mobile phone operators and other entities having access to location data. But when we speak to people, we say, are you aware that you can turn off your location tracking? And they say, yes, but we forgot to do so. And about 20% of the people that we spoke to actually forgot to do it, knew that they could, but forgot. And that's actually something to do with personal responsibility. We want to reduce the element of accidental sharing of location, which comes from more responsibility from commercial organisations and the telephone operators and those kinds of people. And government definitely has got a role.
Music to Chris's ears. Christopher, from a legislative point of view, how robust is our framework for big data and protection of people and and so on?
Well, our framework for data protection is, of course, desperately out of date. The directive is, what,
30 years old or something?
Well launched before, well, big data was ever heard of, I think. And, of course, there's a very prolonged process of legislation through the institutions of the European Union to bring things up to date, and it's taking a long time. But we have to do what we do within the context of the Data Protection Act, which is the directive transposed into UK law. It's very important for a regulator like the Information Commissioner's Office, the ICO, to engage with big data, with the Internet of Things, and to interpret the rules in a way that makes sense of the modern world. We've recently published a policy paper on big data and data protection. We've been conducting a consultation on that, and you can find it on the ICO website, www.ico.org.uk. We also produced a code of practice on anonymization. We helped sponsor the UK Anonymization Network. And we've done all this because we believe not just in enforcement, but we believe in education, we believe in empowering citizens and consumers, and we believe in enabling good things to happen and engaging with the leading edge of technology and so on. So it's five E's, not just enforcement. But I think we mustn't get so carried away by the brave new world of big data that we think that we've somehow suspended gravity. The principles in the data protection directive remain valid. It's how they're applied, and you say, well, who's responsible? Who does the governing? Well, we want to put power in the hands of data controllers and in the hands of citizens and consumers. Not some deus ex machina can make this all work. But it's important to understand that big data developments make sound data protection practices more important, not less important. It's a question of how you do it. Because without citizen and consumer confidence that their rights will be respected, the benefits that big data could deliver in terms of efficiency, smart services, joined up approaches won't be fully realized, because trust is the key. And if you start off by disrespecting individual rights, you forfeit that trust, and then you can't do all the good things that big data offers. And the data protection principles are far more than just notice and consent. It's not that real data protection has been tried and found out. It's the old case of it's been found difficult and hasn't been tried. And now big data seems to give everyone the opportunity to say, well, it wouldn't work anyway because you can't get consent from everybody. So the ICO approach is to show organizations how they can approach big data, managing privacy risks and taking citizens and consumers with them. It's been said this week that privacy isn't an absolute right. Well, nobody said it was. There's certainly a balance to be struck between individual and collective goods. But privacy is a fundamental right, and it's a fundamental right to be taken into account. The attitude that privacy is dead, get over it, risks denying society the real benefits of big data. We'll just trip ourselves up if we assert that. And the arrogant assertion that privacy is dead, get over it, is the 21st century equivalent of the gentleman in Whitehall really does know best. Sorry, it won't play, and I think we all know that.
Thank you very much. How about Europe? How about the person in Europe, the person in Brussels, not just the character in Sir Humphrey and Whitehall?
Well, the person in Europe, of course, includes a whole load of British Euro members of Parliament, a British Secretary of State on the Council of Ministers, and a British member of the Commission. This isn't something that's being done to us by Brussels, but we have got to engage with the process, and it's proving very difficult to get an agreement. But we've got to stop all the grandstanding and get on with the detailed policy making, because Europe, all of it, needs a modern framework for data protection. You've got the big companies trading all over Europe, the global companies. This is a global phenomenon, saying, come on, we can't be dealing with the ICO in the UK, the Germans having different rules, the French having different rules. Just get your act together. So I'm very keen to see an agreement, but it's not easy. It is urgent.
Yeah, sure. Matthew, your organisation has a particular view on this. Are you happy with the direction of travel in regulatory terms?
In regulatory... frustratingly, I think Christopher stole all my best lines, but I'll see what I do. And I genuinely agree that it's horribly outdated, particularly around... I think the greatest thing that concerns our organisation is this idea of prediction and predictive analysis of what happens when personal information, such as our likes on Facebook, can quite quickly turn into sensitive information. One of the greatest issues I've seen recently was a great study conducted by a University of Cambridge professor where he took particular likes on Facebook. Now, likes on Facebook is generally personal information. If I took that you liked the musical Wicked, you liked human rights campaigns, and you liked Ellen DeGeneres, I can reliably predict that you are homosexual based on that research. Now, maybe that's intuitive, but there's a difference between intuition and there's a difference between like peer-reviewed data that has been given the thumbs up academically. And what actually the interesting side of that was when the academic presented that information to his colleagues, one of them said, "You fool, you're going to publish this as a free academic paper? We could have made a bundle out of this." But that's actually, I mean, that's a genuine issue. We don't have a proper framework where we look at prima facie data and properly, robustly assess what it can mean when very sophisticated, and really that isn't that sophisticated as an algorithm, but relatively sophisticated algorithms are placed upon it. And I think if we want to see better business practices, I agree that the harmonization across the region is something that will help, or at least will stop one argument of business, and they will have to go on to another argument that we can focus on. And I also agree that it's not a completely it's not like big data and data protection are unfriendly bedfellows. As Christopher said, data protection principles can work. The difficulty is whether or not we see government being the proper actor in framing big data and regulating it, because it changes so often, because it's so multifarious in its ways. In many ways, we look at something like IBM's ethical framework or IMA's TACT principles as well. These things are helpful because we're seeing much more dynamic attempts to liaise with public. And that's, I think, a much more healthier perspective, because as we say, we're 30 years into a directive that we're still trying to figure out and pass through, that we may see private actors as being incredibly important. And of course, you know, we're not silent subjects here either. People will only act when public really says we've had enough of this. We are genuinely concerned about where our data is going and how it's being used. And I would disagree with Susan Grant Miller when she tried to separate the idea between privacy and control. Privacy is about control in many ways. It's about how we control the data that moves and where it goes. And we need to see that better reflected in the way that we see regulation as well. And that's how we're seeing it a lot at Privacy International.
Excellent. Our first disagreement on the panel. Long may it continue. Susan, did you want to return?
Yeah, I just want to come back on that and say I don't think I was separating the two things out. I was saying that it was an additional layer that goes with this, and that the arguments around privacy just aren't within this small little box.
This small little box of mobility profiles?
No. This is a small box around privacy, the word privacy. I think that it's far more, there are many routes that come out of this and many perspectives on how that should be handled.
Sure.
Oh. It's an agreement after all. Chris, can I just come back to you, because twice in there the role of government came up in reference to the Whitehall man. You're a Whitehall man.
Yes.
Justify yourself.
Well, it's interesting that the mention of Sir Humphrey reminds. Well, let me make one point on setting the framework. I think there's probably a lot to learn for the way the internet's developed, which is essentially a group of organisations have kind of agreed the pitch and the rules of the game and got on with it, and it seems to be working quite well. On the Sir Humphrey point, I was reminded that, and I have credit to one of my team members, Marcus Besley, for this, he found it. There's an episode of Yes Minister from about 25 years ago called Big Brother, and Jim Hacker is setting up the National Population Database, and there are all sorts of, and the civil servant, the Sir Humphrey, is being obstructive around implementing safeguards, and the safeguards are data won't all be held in one place, it'll be separated around departments. Anyone who looks at the data without authorization will be imprisoned, and there will be a record of everyone who does access that data. And that's a way that, I mean, I think that's fascinating that, you know, that's so long ago and all the issues are still alive. It's also fascinating that in Estonia they've actually done that very thing. All their citizens' data, it's not held together, it's held in departments, but it's linked by one unique reference. And so whoever needs the data can access it, and the citizen can log in and see exactly who's accessed it at any particular time. And that notion of agency and empowerment is what makes that system work.
Legislation written by Yes Minister, you heard it here first.
Well, I like the idea of imprisonment for... it's actually on the statute, ladies and gentlemen, it's just awaiting commencement.
A lot of what we've been talking about has to do with the security of the data. Carol, how secure can our data ever be?
So I've got this tough question, but I want to answer it with reference to what I know best about, which is the use of data for patient and public benefit in health services, and also to just step back a little bit and say that the answer to that question is relative to its use. So I think echoing Susan's earlier comments very much about the proportionality and our understanding of the huge benefits that can be, that can follow publicly.
Well, certainly and others can chip in on other topics.
So I feel that the issue is really about managing disclosure, and I'm sure that we're going to hear from Mandy about the technical side, are clearly essential, and I think having secure systems, having using the best of encryption to protect against, you know, malicious intent is very important, and important reassurance to have. And likewise, I think it's all about people, so we need training and we need safeguards and we need people to understand their responsibilities when they're handling data. So I'm going to take that as said and then try and draw out some other issues where I think that the model of consent is one that deserves scrutiny here in terms of protecting against a risk. And what I think we need to refer to really is the work that's been done with the public and our understanding about what public perceptions are about how these risks should be managed. And I would argue that we need to develop more of a strong and transparent partnership with the public to achieve that. The risks that people are concerned about are very similar actually to transport. They want it used for public benefit. They want, for example, the information to go back into the health service without necessarily the health service paying twice for it. They're happy, I think, for commercial use where it will be for patient benefit, but perhaps not so much where it will be for marketing purposes, and I think there's a distinction there. And there are concerns about unsanctioned use, including by data controllers, and also about police and forensic use. And underpinning that is that we need to be able to demonstrate the benefits but still protect people's rights to dissent. And I think that, you know, in the NHS and Social Care Act, we know that that's an important philosophy, and we're all users of big data as researchers, but we're also the public whose data are in these data sets, and I think we would like to see that standard operating for us. So the big question I think that's asked here is what is for public benefit and who decides? And I would argue that we need a data system that actually provides much more partnership in making a judgment, because it is a judgment, it isn't always evident what is for public benefit. And in looking at that, I mean, I have a great long list of fantastic examples which we've used in similar talks like this to demonstrate the benefits, but I just want to draw to your attention to a couple of issues where I think the challenge really is how would you get individual level consent? Is it feasible and is it consistent with getting reliable, timely and effective answers to questions that are really of public importance? So in the MMR and autism, which I was involved with, we know that the countries that had linked data sets were able to get much more robust and reliable information out to parents in a much more timely way than we were able to. I know that by linking in a highly secure way information on maternal HIV status in the dried blood spots of their babies, we've been able to reduce the mother-to-child transmission together with effective interventions from 20% to less than 0.5% in my professional lifetime, and that's and introduce a universal screening for that, and that has to be a fantastic benefit. We know that in Scandinavia, where they can link more than 1 million donors, blood donors, to 15 million donations, to 1.5 million recipients, of 11 million transfusions, that they can show they have a good, robust system for any safety concerns, and they were able to answer very simple questions like, can you catch cancer through a blood transfusion? You know, very, very basic things that you couldn't do if you had to go for individual consent. We know that in Scotland, Gordon Smith managed to link mothers who had had stillbirths to their subsequent pregnancies to produce very reliable information about what the risk might be of that happening to them again. I can't think of a better use in talking to mothers. So all these very large scale things where we're dealing with very rare outcomes and we need reliable information, need to have consent. And we know when we've looked at record linkage consents in cohort studies, that the kind of people who say no and who are concerned are socially disadvantaged, less educated, perhaps from who don't have English as a first language. You know, we've looked at this in the Millennium cohort. So what you're doing by imposing consent actually is disenfranchising selectively certain groups of the population whose information and data then can't be used to inform policy. So I think those issues about transparency and partnership are key. But I do think we need to think about systems and not just individuals, and in particular to think about a different approach to assent and consent that can take into account some of the really big challenges we have to getting big data to really maximise its benefit. I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you. Keeping on the, well, trying to get back to this idea of security, you know, you presumably have, 20 patents in various forms of keeping data secure. Are you confident that IBM, when it collects people's data, can maintain the security that they would expect?
So I think when you look at security, you have to think about it in a number of aspects. So when we think about securing something physical, often we're trying to make sure that we've got it to use when we want it. So the notion of keeping the data in a secure centre, you know, making sure that people can't literally steal the disks that the data's on. So there's a physical security aspect. And then there's a question about will you be able to still get value from this data? And that would be determined by how much uniqueness there is in that data. Is it something that you can get anywhere, or is this data unique and difficult to collect? Is it useful for the purpose? I mean, you can collect an awful lot of data that is actually of no use to you whatsoever. So, you know, the security aspects around that are more that you have no idea what you've got when you get too much data. Then we have the trustworthiness of the data, and this is very important, and perhaps it comes back to the role of government, because when you collect data, it's not just about collecting those values, but you need to collect the context in which that data was collected, partly for consent, or, you know, and to understand the rules in which it was collected, but also to understand its significance and what were the assumptions that were made when that data was collected. So actually having standards on what we should collect around that context is a key enabler for many organisations, particularly when they're sharing data. And then how consumable is it? How easy is it to get the data that you need? So this is really about its value, and that determines in some respects how secure and how much you want to invest in security. Because it's pretty much, as you were saying, it's more of a it's more of a how much do you invest in order for them to get the value out of the data. And then the final one really is ensuring that no damage is incurred. And this is really around the privacy issue, about whether people make mistakes. And again, this context that's kept around data stops people from misinterpreting common terms that we use in every day, but for different groups of people have very different meanings. And that, you know, obviously you can say, well, is that really security? In many respects, it's about confidence in using data, and that's one of the aspects that we're trying to achieve with security. The other is loss of reputation. So for many businesses, they have damaged their reputation by making inappropriate use of data. And of course, exploitation of vulnerable people is a key concern, because that data, I love the example of the prediction of whether someone's homosexual or not, because in many respects there are going to be many facts about things that are actually hidden from view, but there are little nuggets of information dotted around, and as we bring more and more data together, we have no idea what that's going to reveal. I mean, a lot of social science is about finding those patterns in data to really understand that. So the definition of security is not so much about physical nature and whether you allow a limited amount of people to access it. It's really then what you do with that data and how you derive data and how you process it that is the more subtle side of security. So there are mechanisms to prevent people from accessing data. Ultimately, you need to, for it to be useful, you need to allow somebody to access it. Mm. And then you're into a question of risk. Is that person trustworthy? Mm-hmm. How can we ensure that that data doesn't change in order to be misleading? And then how do you make sure that data is used appropriately? And I think, you know, when you look at security today of IT systems, they're under constant attack. And they're under constant attack by very intelligent people. Which means that the response to security has to be ongoing, evolving, sort of a constant focus on looking at where the threats are and how to manage the risk around that data. And that's true of any IT system, whether it's got big data in it or small data, should I say.
Thank you very much. The main thing that sort of jumped out at me there was no matter how well you design security systems now, there's an uncertainty in the future.
Yes.
For example, being able to link things together. And Carl, you've done some work around around the role that social media plays. So, I mean, we've largely talked about the collection of data, but there's a huge amount of people that are just offering up for themselves. Can you talk us through the implications of that?
That's right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, very, very good afternoon to you all. And I think that, so I'm a social media researcher, and big data for me is the big data, which is, as was just said, like often that freely offered, it seems to us. It's initially freely offered on social media all the time in utterly unprecedented qualities, quantities and richnesses. And that to us looks like a whole new way of learning about people. And Demos has always been concerned about trying to find new ways of putting the kind of public voice in the debate. And social media kind of offers a kind of a notion of enormous democratic potential that could potentially make government and governance more agile and more responsive to citizens' concerns. But there is this huge kind of opportunity, this huge promise which we can see in front of us. But the unfortunate fact is that outside of this room, big data is being given a terrible bashing. The framing is that big data is something which is being done to people, not that they are participating in. Facebook is coming and after your data, there's this privacy invasion from this large technology company, there's that privacy invasion from that technology company, people are losing your data, your data's being hacked. Kind of story after story after story is kind of echoing this frame, that basically the big data revolution has kind of locked out the normal person. The normal person is not part of the party. And instead, kind of big data is something which is being used to make technology companies and the rich and the technologically capable more powerful than they were before. and the people that were on the wrong side of that divide less powerful than they were before. And this is incredibly worrying. And I think that the attitudinal picture here is quite clear, and it's moving in the wrong direction. People trust every organisation across the board less with their data than they do normally, and they trust the organisations that have most of their data least of all. So the internet companies and the social media companies have barely any trust at all from people in their data and using their data appropriately. Now, this is incredibly worrying indeed, and I really think that we are walking towards a kind of consumer rights kind of scandal, a consumer rights crisis. And the real fear for someone like me, a social media researcher, is we're already beginning to see the kind of mass withdrawal of consent by action. So people are just stopping using these platforms. They're just transferring more of their activity onto encrypted systems. They're moving out of the light net and onto the dark net. And they're not just criminals or terrorists that are beginning to use the dark net. It's privacy conscious citizens that with perfectly legitimate aims that are often using that. And they've now had such little kind of trust in the regime which we have that there's a growing and I think already fairly widespread idea that the only way in which you can actually truly make yourself safe, the only way that you can truly make your privacy secure, is to do it yourself. Is to begin to use end-to-end pretty good privacy, end-to-end encryption, literally make it impossible for people to get hold of your data. Now, that's often actually, I think, due to the public perception of the strength of the regime as much as it's with the regime itself. And whether it's the Data Protection Act or the Regulation of Investigative Powers Act, the kind of like legal frameworks which govern certainly how government and data processors can access it, there's an enormous gulf between actually what people think is there and what is actually there. So Ripper, we have this, you know, there's a legitimate debate about whether the legal frameworks intelligence agencies work within are robust for the digital age. But actually the widespread belief from most British people is intelligent, there is no framework at all. That the British intelligence agencies kind of get hold of and use your data however they want. And I think that there are three things which are driving this gulf, and three things which are really moving public perception in a very, very worrying direction, and it's this. First off, we have a fundamental problem of how to legislate in this area. Technology use is moving faster than law. Technology use is moving faster than regulation. We haven't yet learnt how we can keep up to date with the kind of white heat of the kind of 21st century technology. And whilst that remains the case, the temptation has always been to kind of move towards technology agnostic legislation of one kind or another. Stuff which can be used regardless of where things go. If anyone remembers here the communications data bill debate we've recently had, that was the plan. We don't know what capabilities are going to be like in 5 years' time, so we have to basically design legislation which can deal with anything. And then that legislation becomes so broad and so manipulable and so flexible that we don't really know how it's going to be used at all, and the whole thing fell apart. So problem one is this kind of fundamental discord and disjuncture between technology and law. Kind of problem two is there is also a fundamental disjuncture between public perception and technology. So people really have very little idea, and know they have very little idea, about what the possibilities are using all these emerging muscular new analytics technologies to learn stuff about them. And they know that capability is constantly changing. They know that has implications for privacy, and they don't know what that is. So the parts actually of the whole regime that we can see that people are most concerned about are the kind of analytics developers, the kind of those slightly shadowy technology startups that have no kind of consumer facing side, no retail branch. They're the people that are creating all these new amazing new technologies which are presenting all these new difficult implications for privacy. And actually, we've done some deliberative work where you kind of take people through the process, you explain what these technologies can do, you explain what implications for privacy they have. And actually, you can see that. Oh, that's how passionately I feel about this. you can see that people's concerns actually increase as they learn more about what all these things can do. And then problem number three, thank you, sorry everyone for that. Problem number three is that at the time when I think we all agree that we need privacy most, and absolutely, kind of Zuckerberg's claim that privacy is dead, I think is as outrageous as it is profit orientated, is actually the time when we least know what privacy really is. Because right at the internet, social media, these are disruptive technologies which are both created by society but also change them. And one of the things that we've clearly seen social media do is actually fracture the idea of privacy. Privacy is not dead, but it's scattering off in lots of different directions. So a small part of people, yes indeed, actually share more parts of their lives than anyone ever has before and have very few concerns of doing so. About 1 in 10 of us, mainly young people, that is true. But then about 30% of us actually try and share as little parts of our lives as possible and have huge concerns anyway with it all. Many more of us are on the other side. And then everyone else is in fairly tribal shades of grey in between. So the third problem is that when we're trying to protect privacy, we also actually don't really know what privacy is anymore. And we know that actually privacy is becoming quite a personalised thing, a highly contextual thing. Something which you can only really understand when you have a particular person, you talk them through a particular context. So trying to provide this kind of generic, national, or even EU-wide kind of legislation which begins to kind of define and encapsulate that is incredibly difficult indeed. So those are, I think, the problems. Those are the things that I think are driving this. And then I think the kind of solutions, really, I mean, are things that have already been mentioned before. I think that choice has to become key. I mean, if privacy is going to be individualised, you have to give people the conception of defining privacy for themselves. The one thing I'll add to all these other things that have been said, probably two additional kind of principles.
Two quick ones.
Sorry. Yeah. Right. Transparency. The kind of public understanding of what is possible has to improve. They have to understand what this technology can do. And the other one, I think, is bargaining power. I think for too long the kind of dynamic has been, if you want to use Facebook, you want to use Gmail, you've got to sign up to these incredibly permissive terms of services, and then the data is basically used as you want. You've got to allow people to have a stronger bargaining position with technology companies and define basically more choice in exactly what services they get for what data they give out.
Yeah. Emma, just coming to you finally, Carl's raised three depressing problems and two ingenious solutions, but he really talking about that kind of sleepwalking towards a crisis. Is public accountability something that we can weave into this to avoid that crisis?
I mean, the thing is, I mean, the question, public accountability, you've got two big terms there, the public. What is that? We've been talking about the ordinary people, the normal person. I think I'm those. Aren't we all those things? So the question of who the public is really out there. And I'm drawn to thinking about Paulo Freire's position on in the pedagogy of the oppressed. He talks about this, you know, there aren't the marginalised people and the non-marginalised. It's we're all in one system, and it's not that some people are kind of more public or less public. We're all using this data together and making the data shape us that backwards. The other part to that term, public accountability, of course, is accountability. And here we have a real problem. Again, something that I think Barbara Adams speaks to very well in terms of the future. How do we hold people accountable to things that are intrinsically temporal, the future orientated things, the future beasts, if you like, future questions. The benefits change in the future, the choices change in the future, my trust levels change in the future. How do we grapple with the futurity or the future embeddedness of what we're dealing with, and how do we work choice, time, and so on? And we've got, I mean, the future is always presented as a sort of thing that's out there. But of course we've got all kinds of, we've got real time things. So increasingly the predictive analytics is about nowcasting, using social media, other forms of real time data. It's now, it wants to know things that are happening now. Yes, other things are about the future and a longer term, but these require different decisions and different methodologies, different policies and different systems. We've also got the issue of you know, the expert and non-expert in public accountability, but I want to suggest that it's not, that's almost red herring. And actually, what we need more of within these debates is kind of different kinds of communication between the different parties, the experts, the non-experts, the mathematicians that are kind of doing this, the non-mathematicians. The public, again, is like, what you know, big word, but we need more diverse communication within that, which may or may not be helped by education and training. And we can be, I have to speak from an educational point of view, from that's where I'm sat, but we can be more creative in terms of the education we deliver. At Brown University, for example, has created these new PhDs, where a kind of minor, you do an MA in anthropology, followed by, alongside a PhD in engineering. And I think that's a really interesting way of thinking about how we might train communication differently, to learn to speak to non-experts and experts in different fields. And finally, I think public accountability always needs to account for, or think about and consider, the most vulnerable in our society. And we typically think of the most vulnerable society as, you know, young people, disabled and aged and so on, and or all kinds of socially excluded, whatever you want to term that now as. But it's also, I mean, I feel I'm vulnerable when I don't understand the all the technologies and the algorithms behind it. I think increasingly we're all a little bit vulnerable in relation to a lot of this stuff. And I don't know how we create data guardians in the same way as we have done in relation to consent and ethical issues, where people just can't, you know, it's not about giving them a choice of consent. They haven't got the capacity to make a decision on these things, either because of the babies or, you know, whatever the reason is. But I often don't also have the kind of informed perspective of this. And I think increasingly, this idea of accountability needs to consider kind of maybe almost like groups of data guardians around some of these issues.
Okay, thank you very much.